live here, Professor Nadimon and myself. And we have a, okay, I think we are have 5 minutes to go. And yes, our next speaker is Professor Glaucio Paulino, who will talk about origami stuff. And I'm seeing this, I'm handle the floor now to Professor Nadimon. Ney, good okay. to see you.
Okay, thank you, Alvo. I think Glaucio is already there, isn't he? Okay, then it's my greatest pleasure to introduce my good friend and colleague, Professor Paulino. Professor Paulino joined Princeton University this fall, September, has just joined as the Margareta Augustine Professor of Engineering. Prior to joining Princeton, he was the Raymond Allen Jones Chair at the Georgia Tech, so Georgia Institute of Technology. His contributions in the area of applied mechanics include the development of methodologies to characterize the deformation and fracture behavior of existing and emerging materials and the structural systems, topology optimization for multi-scale, multi-physics problems, variational methods, deployable structures, and origami engineering, which is the topic of the lecture today. Last year, he simultaneously received the Drucker Medal for the American Society of Mechanical Engineers, ASME, and the Mendeley Medal for the American Society of Civil Engineers, or ASC. He also received the 2015 Cozzarelli Prize for the National Academy of Sciences, which recognizes recently published papers of the proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, so PNAS, of outstanding scientific excellence and originality. In his lecture, he will tell us about the contents of this paper. He's presently a member of the Executive Committee of the Applied Mechanics Division of ASME and a former president of the Society of Engineering Sciences. He's a member of the U.S. National Academy of Engineering, election to the National Academy of Engineering is considered to be among the highest recognitions in engineering-related fields, and it often comes as a recognition of a lifetime's worth of accomplishment. Today, he will talk about origami engineering simulations from metamaterials to robots. Please, Glaucio, take the floor.
Thank you, Ney. Can you see my slides?
Yes, we are seeing it. Yeah.
Okay.
Can you see it?
No, not yet. Just one second. Right now. Thank you.
Okay. Ney, can you see the slides?
Yes. We are seeing it. Okay. You and the slides.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ney, for the introduction. And thanks, Alvaro. And thanks for the organizers for inviting me to give the lecture. Marcela said, it's a pleasure to meet everyone at a distance, although it would be nicer if we could have had the event in person, but maybe the next one will be in person. So, I am going to talk about origami engineering simulations from metamaterials to robots. So, Ney, what do you think about this image here on the right-hand side? Do you like it?
Oh, yes, Glaucio. I'm actually intrigued by this image. And what is that?
This is the zipper tube, and this is an origami configuration that will be one of the main ideas that we are going to discuss during the talk. Yeah.
Looks like a ladder to the sky. I don't know. It looks like magic.
Yeah. Do you like magic, Ney?
Oh, yes, of course. Yeah.
Very good. So then we can talk about magic. And actually, regarding origami, we have this paper by Houdini, and he wrote this book in 1922. And look here what he did. For example, he had a technique that you could fold the paper and just with one cut of a scissor, then you could get any image. And here, for example, you can get the star. This is the star of the American flag. And since you said that you like magic, then maybe we can take a look at a video that may show what we can do now. Because, for example, here, as you can see, is just one star. But since Houdini, right, a lot of science, technology, mathematics has developed. And what can we do now? Carlos, can you show us the video?
Okay, so here's the fold in one cut crease pattern. And within this, the red lines are mountain folds and the blue lines are valley folds. And then when all of those folds are folded up, all of the green lines will be on top of each other and they can be all cut using a single cut. So once we have that crease pattern, it gets engraved onto a piece of paper.
But
the full pattern can be folded up, resulting in something that looks like this. If I unfold part of this, you can see this is the MCE part of the word, and then the rest of the letters are in here. But along this, there is a line right here, and that was the green line from the original crease pattern. So when everything is folded up, that green line forms a single straight line. So we can take some scissors and cut along that line. There we go. Okay. So now the top part has been cut off, and we have all of these smaller pieces. So each of these are a letter. So if we unfold them, you should be able to see the cutout word. And you can also take the leftover paper from the fold in one cut, and if you unfold it, you'll get a negative of the letters. So take this, which will look like this.
Thank you very much, Carlos. Ney, I hope you enjoyed it. And now you could see that, for example, we evolved from a single figure like what Houdini has done just for the star. And you could see that what we did was silence, right? And here, what we used was the skeleton theory. It's a mathematical theory to do this, plus free folding and flat foldability rules. And here you can see the offset lines, the midlines, the skeletons, the cut lines. The cut lines are very clear because they are silence. And here is the midlines, the skeletons, and cut lines view. And finally, we have the mountain and valley assignment. And this was folded, and with one cut, we got each letter of a silence, the positive, and then we also got the entire thing, as you could see. And this actually was part of the PhD thesis of Larissa. Larissa was a student of Professor Ney Dumont, and she did her master at PUC-Rio, and then she came to Georgia Tech and did her PhD. All right, so. Now, let's go to origami engineering simulations from metamaterials to robots. And before I go on, I would like to acknowledge Nupur. Nupur is the lady who did the video for us. Tu Ozao, Efigeni Filipov, Tomohiro Tashi, Horacio Espinosa, Sirida Krishnazami, René Zao, Kelio, Pradeep Pratapa, Larissa Novellino, the Brazilian student that did the master with Professor Ney Dumont, Shijize Shuai Wu, Heimin Wei, Nicholas Alderet, and Zhao Wenlin. And the sponsors of this work were NSF, JSPS, and the Raymond Alan Jones Chair. Here's the roadmap for my talk. First, I'll give an introduction to origami engineering, and then talk a little bit about the ODC program that we had at NSF. I worked at the National Science Foundation of the United States a few years ago, and we helped to create the ODC program called Origami Design for Integration of Self-Assembling Systems for Engineering Innovation. Then I'll talk about reduced order models and the bar and hinge model to do analysis of origami and introduce the Merlin software. Then I talk about coupling of origami tubes and the zipper tubes. That is the first one I showed in the first slide. What do we do with those? Maybe metamaterial cellular assemblages. And then I will talk about the very recent work on origami robots and conclude the talk. So origami has been quite pervasive and has been used in many areas, has been used as art, in entertainment, in the fashion industry, in education. And here I am going to highlight this piece of art here by Eric Joazel. And this is the full slide now. If you count, there are 11 pieces of origami here. There are 11 musicians and 11 instruments. And there are only 22 pieces of paper here. One piece of paper for each musician and one piece of paper for each instrument. Okay, and this is one of the most expressive type of origami I have ever seen in my life. And this origami pieces, they are available in the Origami Gallery in Japan. If you go there, I strongly recommend that you visit the Origami Gallery. When we talk about engineering applications of origami, the words that come into mind are compact, deployable, prefabricated, self-assembly, tunable, multifunctional, adaptable. And here are a few applications, and one of the main ones, for example, are space applications. If anything is going to space, that has to go inside rockets. Rockets are small, therefore origami has to play a big role because the thing has to fit inside a rocket before it's deployed in space. And in origami engineering, we need elements from theory and analysis that I am going to address during this talk. And we need elements from design, as you can see here. And this is, for example, here on the top right-hand side, this is the Origamizer by Tomohiro Tashi. This has thousands of creases. Creases are the blueprint of origami, okay? This has thousands of creases, and then Tashi folded the famous origami bunny here. And then we need elements also from materials and fabrication. So now, as I indicated, I worked at NSF a few years ago, and we created, as part of the EFRI program, Imagine Frontiers in Research and Innovation. Then we created the EFRI program called ODYSSEY, Origami Design for Integration of Self-Assembly Systems for Engineering Innovation, that consisted of using math plus artistic inspiration to engineer active materials, design theory, origami, and adaptive morphing systems. It had four main areas involving compliant mechanisms, active materials, bio-origami, protein folding, DNA folding, and foldable structures and microstructures. And it promoted a lot of collaborations between different communities in the United States. And origami has four basic rules. Just wonder how I can remove this part from the top of these slides. Oh, that's okay. Origami has four basic rules. And here at the center, for example, you see a piece of art by Robert Lang. This is a flat foldable origami. And these rules include, for example, two colorability, the Maekawa theorem, the Kawasaki theorem, and the no interpenetration of folds. And you may wonder how just four rules could be so powerful and dictate all the behavior of origami. But if you think, for example, about quantum mechanics, the rules are very simple, but they govern, and they can be written, for example, in a napkin, but they govern all of chemistry, all of life. And that's a similar situation here with origami. And it is the same mathematical rules that we saw in the previous slide that they lead to engineering innovations. And here, in the center of the slide, we can see the space station. And now I will elaborate a little bit on each of the four rules. For example, we have the two colorability. Any flat foldable origami should be able to be colored with two colors only. And we can prove that the crease pattern is associated to an Eulerian graph. And the Eulerian graphs can be colored with two colors only. Then we have the Maekawa theorem that tells us that the difference between mountains and valleys is two and two only, no more, no less. And the Kawasaki theorem, that is a very powerful theorem that says that if we look around the vertex, and if we consider the odd angles, they will add to 180 degrees, and the same thing for the even angles. And we should have no interpenetration of folds for origami, okay? And then we use these ideas to create a new class in origami engineering that was created in 2017 at Georgia Tech. And one of the ideas we used there was the idea of origami Legos to teach about rigid origami. I was inspired by a toy company in Japan, but the angles were limited. Then we extended the angles. We printed thousands of Legos so that the students could have fun. And here is Larissa, the student that did the master with Professor Dumont at UP Rio, playing with the Legos and illustrating, for example, Miura tube. Done with the Legos, and this will be one of the topics in the lecture. I'm going to address the Miura tubes very soon. So what do you do with this? If you pick up the Legos, for example, and we do that in the class, and assemble them in this configuration, then you are going to get the Miura pattern. If you do it in a butterfly configuration like this, you are going to get the Eggbox pattern. These two patterns are very famous, very used in engineering, I would say. Maybe the Miura is the most used developable pattern, and the Eggbox is the most used non-developable pattern. And then at the end of the class, the students do a trade show and very interesting projects that are interdisciplinary, like here the origami resistor, layer jamming, origami light, and so on. So let's talk about how we can program properties of origami, and I will concentrate on the Poisson ratio. Let's say that we have the Miura Ori. Coming back again, I introduced the Miura Ori, and here is the unit cell. What happened is, in plane, we can show that the Miura Ori has a negative Poisson ratio. If you shrink it in one direction, you shrink in all the directions. However, out of plane, it has a positive Poisson ratio, and it will form, if you bend it, it will form this saddle configuration that you just saw. Now, let's look at the Eggbox. We have just seen it in the class that indicated to you that we introduced, and here is the Eggbox. Now, in plane, it will have a positive Poisson ratio like any other material that we know. That's the standard class of materials, and the Eggbox follows that. However, if you look in bending, if you bend it, it will form like a dome that is typical of auxetic materials with a negative out-of-plane Poisson ratio, okay? Now, these patterns have been studied a lot, and the group in Harvard, for example, they parameterized a few years ago, they parameterized the Miura Ori, and with the expressions shown here, and did a lot of math and a lot of derivations, and finally, they computed analytical expressions for the Poisson ratio in bending that is given by this expression, and in plane that is given by this expression. If you compare both of them, take a look. The only difference is the sign. So this is an extremely elegant result. And then a few years later, a group in France, they studied the Eggbox, and finally, they derived the analytical expressions for the Poisson ratio in bending and in plane. Compare again, the only difference is the sign. So very elegant results, very intriguing results. And then we were intrigued by these results and these patterns. And one question that we asked is that these are two different metamaterials. Would it be possible for us, for example, to have a single metamaterial that we have all the properties that we saw in these two? It turns out that the answer is yes, and that's what we did. For example, if we program all the unit cells to be in the Miura mode, then it will behave like the Miura pattern, as you can see here. Now, if I program all the cells, if I change all the cells, and pick up this here, that is all the cells are in the Miura mode, I change them, change to the Eggbox, then it will have the properties like you saw in the Eggbox pattern. The key difference is that here we have two different materials, as you have seen, but here the morph that we created is only one, it's the same, that can have both. So we also studied in very detail the mathematical expressions for the Poisson ratio in bending and in stretch. And in bending, It is defined in a similar fashion to what we define the Poisson ratio in stretched. In stretches, the negative of the ratio of the stretches, and in bending is the negative of the ratio of curvatures. Okay, and then after a lot of derivations, we got to this expression, and then we also evaluated the Poisson ratio in stretch and got this expression, and if you compare them, the only difference is the sign. Therefore, the Poisson ratio in stretch is the negative of the one in bending. This is an extremely elegant result, very intriguing. And many times what we can see is that the derivations are very elegant because the elegance in the geometry, the pattern, translates into elegance in the mathematics that translates into elegance into the mechanics, as we have seen here. So this work was published in Physical Review Letters, and it is on geometric mechanics of origami patterns exhibiting Poisson's ratio switch by breaking mountain and valley assignment. And the reference is here. And for example, there are many details in this work. I'll just highlight a few ideas here so that we can move on. But what do you do with this? For example, if I pick up a tessellation and I program this side with Miura cells and this side with egg box, I can choose, I can program any way. I have an infinite way to create metamaterials. I can do it any way I wish. And then I do it that way. When you bend, you can see that this side here behaves like the egg box, has a dome type behavior. And this side behaves like the Miura, has a saddle type configuration. And now if I program it like this, I alternate egg box and Miura unit cells, I program it like that. Then if I bend, it will have a behavior similar to that. And more details are available in the PRL paper. Now, I want to go back to the Miura tubes. If I pick up two strips of origami like this, put them together, I get a tube. And this has been studied a lot by means of kinematic rigid folding. And, however, here, since we are doing mechanics, we are interested in the elastic deformations. What we wanted to do is a reduced order model, a simplified model, that would allow us to get the origami response very quickly. We want to get the response in a minute or so. We don't want to wait too long. And then what we did was to capture only three basic deformation modes. This is a simplified, a reduced order model. And the one deformation mode would be for to capture panel shear and stretch. And we use bar elements, as you can see here. And here is the full tube model. The other deformation mode that is extremely important is how to capture the bending of the panels. And then we introduce an artificial crease here along which we are going to have rotations that will indicate the amount that the panel will bend. And finally, we have the fold bending. And this is the rotations that we are going to capture along the actual crease line. And these models, they were originated by Schenck and Guest. Later, we extended the idea to consider some of the properties that you see here, and more recently extended it to finite deformations. So essentially then, to capture panel shear and stretch for each member, we have the usual stiffness here of the system that we can get to capture the bending of the panel, we can have an expression similar to this. And many times I can correlate the stiffness of the facets with the stiffness of the crease with the stiffness of the facets. This allows us then to construct the stiffness matrix for the system, considering just the three basic deformation modes. And now we want to understand origami through mechanics. The point I would like to make is that previously, rigid origami has dominated, but rigid origami can only deform through folding, okay? And cannot capture, for example, things like what you see here, that if you bend, then the origami, as we have seen, then this can only happen if you consider the non-rigid origami. The rigid origami assumptions are not going to work. One idea is to use finite elements to do this, and some groups have done it. For example, here is the work of Professor Pellegrino at Caltech. You can see that just to generate this mesh and do this analysis may take a long time. Our goal is to develop a simplified approach to analyze the nonlinear mechanics of non-rigid origami so that we can do the analysis very fast. Essentially, in Merlin, this essentially leads to the creation of the software Merlin that I am going to briefly explain. It only has two basic elements. One is the bar element, and we use a hyperelastic constitutive law. Then we have a strain energy function. We do one derivative, we get the stress, one more derivative, we get the modulus. And since this is 1D, instead of tensors, then these are scalars. And this will give me enough information so that I can build the internal force vector and the stiffness matrix for the system, considering both material and geometric nonlinearities. Again, pay attention that here everything is elastic, is highly nonlinear, but is hyperelastic. And the most important element is the rotation element. Suppose that I have two panels, as you see here, and we have this dihedral angle theta, okay? Then we use a similar approach to before. We have a strain energy function, we do one derivative, we get the moment, another derivative, then we get the stiffness. And then we can build the internal force vector and the stiffness matrix. Now, what happened is, in general, we would have to treat contact, but actually, instead of doing that explicitly, we transfer the contact responsibility to the constitutive model. Essentially, when this angle theta is 0 degree, or when the angle theta is 2 pi, okay, then the system, the two faces may get into contact, then we create barrier functions here so that the contact will not be favored. It's basically just a penalization so that contact would be avoided. And in general, this will take care of the local contact. If it is non-local, then that will not take care of it. And rotations are extremely important in origami, and we need to treat the entire range of rotations. This dihedral angle here should go from 0 until 2 pi. And the configuration 0 and 2 pi may look the same, but they are totally, completely different, totally different, totally different. Now, if I use the standard trigonometric function like the arc cosine, as you can see here, what happens is I cannot differentiate angles between 0 and pi and pi and 2 pi. That's impossible. Now, if I introduce the sine function, then I create a discontinuity. But if I add the module 2 pi, I get the red line here, and then I will have what I want, a unique way to define the angles uniquely for the entire range from 0 until 2 pi. And now, as you can see here in the illustration for the angle theta, then we have a unique way to differentiate angles that are close to 0, bigger than 0, 100, 200, 300 degrees until 2 pi. This is extremely important. And now, one more remark is that whenever we are building our internal force vectors and stiffness matrices, we need derivatives. And if we use standard approaches, we are going to use trigonometric functions, and we are going to have it in the denominator. And like you have here, the sine of theta. And then your computer code is not going to work. Because whenever the thing is zero, your computer code is going to blow up. And although the limit is finite, but your code will not know that, then what we did was to rewrite this in terms of vector and tensor function so that at the end, we have an expression like that that can be computed for the entire range of deformations. And again, the same idea applies for the Hessian when we build the stiffness matrices, and then we are going to have derivatives like this, and this symbol here is the tensor product, a different tensor product that is defined here. And at the end, you can see the point is we have no trigonometric functions. And this was the key idea to allow us to have Merlin that would, the computer code that would have, that would be able to treat finite deformations and to treat the nonlinear mechanics of non-rigid origami. The reference is given here at the bottom of the page. And the solver that we used was a modified generalized displacement control method. The references are here. Essentially, this is a modified version of the arc length method. And now, for example, what can you do as Merlin? For example, you see if you have this tessellation here, and this is a shell, a big shell, you see with many units, then just imagine if you are going to do an FEM of this, this may take quite long just to generate the mesh. But with Merlin, you can easily generate the mesh because a reduced order model, and then set up your problem with your boundary conditions and solve the problem. For example, if I do a pop-through defect, a PTD, this is a study that was done in a paper in Science a few years ago, then you go with your finger there, for example, and you pop through the defect so that it's bistable. It will go from the you can see that the Miura is like that. Then when you pop through the defect, it will snap and go down, right? And that's what is shown here. You can see that point where you pop through the defect is highly nonlinear and has snap through and snap back. And now you can, for example, look at the energy landscape, and I only have three deformation modes, right? This area here is the stretching energy, this area is the bending energy, and this is the folding energy, and the red is the total energy profile. And then I can study the system, I can understand the stability, the bistability, and everything that is going on. And this, in the interest of time, I was planning to do a demo just to show you that the code Merlin was written in MATLAB, is educational, is very efficient, but I am not going to do it. This simulation only take 1 minute, the one I just showed you, and you can download the code freely on my website. The link is provided here. If you have any question, you can ask me or send me email, and all the explanation about the code is provided here on this reference at the bottom of the slide. It's a paper in the Proceedings of the Royal Society in 2017. Okay, so now let me shift gears a little bit and talk about the tubes. And first, we started to look, for example, at the energy, at the eigenvalues versus extension of an origami sheet, as you can see here. And I started to look at the eigenvalues 7, 8, 9, 10. I start from 7 because the first 6 are rigid body modes, then those are 0. And we were interested in the band gap. As you can see here, nothing interesting is happening. And then we look at a tube, a single tube, and then we have a little bit of a band gap here, but not that interesting. And then we looked at tube assemblages. For example, we align tubes, as you can see here. And then we have a tube inside a tube, as you can see here. And finally, the zipper tube. That is the one on the first slide that I have shown. And look what happened. With a single tube, the band gap, not that exciting, is small. I need this band gap to be big. And then with aligned tubes, also not that exciting. With internal tube, what happened is the internal one will lock the system. You cannot extend 100%. It will lock. But then when we did the zipper, look what happened. This was very exciting. I have a near zero, very low energy mode. That is the axial one. And all the other deformation modes, they require much more energy, as you can see here. This was very exciting. This work is the work that Professor Dumont mentioned that was published in PNAS that received the Quazzarelli Prize a few years ago. And then why does this work? In the interest of time, I'll just explain here the zipper. This is the energy landscape. And if you look here, this is the energy for shear and stretch, bending and folding, green, red, and blue. And if you look for the first mode, almost all the energy is for folding, and that's what you want. And this requires almost no energy, very low energy. And all the higher order modes, then the energies are more in bending and stretching and shear. And if you compare relatively, you can see that the first mode is a near zero energy term, a very low energy to deploy the system. But all the other higher order modes, they require tremendous energy. Take a look here. For the first mode, the mode 7, most of the energy is in folding as you want, but for the higher order modes, then you will engage the panel in shear and the stretch and bending. So what do you do with this? Maybe cellular assemblages because and metal materials, because with origami, we can benefit from self-assembling, deployability, tunability, and so on. And here is a metal material, what is called a configurational metal material, that is made of an assembly of zipper tubes with aligned tubes. And I will show this animation again because it's very important. Just note that, this metal material is flat foldable in two different directions. You see this one and this one, two different directions. And It has interesting properties. For example, look here in the XY plane, is auxetic. It has some interesting properties, exciting properties. And look here at the stiffness versus extension, then it's very stiff in the Z direction and quite soft in a very big range in the X and Y directions. And there is something strange here at the end in the Y direction. This is this peak, and this is a geometric singularity that happens when all the panels are aligned, because then the metamaterial has to decide if it is going to go left or right. It's impossible. It is just one instance, one configuration that only exists at a point, and then it has to decide any movement. It has to go one way or the other, and that's that singularity point. Okay?
Klaus,
yes.
Klaus, may I interrupt you?
Yes.
Hello? Oh, yeah. What is this you are showing now? This just the zipper tube you had showed in the first slide, or is this something else?
Yes, this essentially, very good question, is essentially it's just an assembly of the zipper tubes. And here, the zipper assembled with the align. Okay,
thank you.
Welcome. And what do you do with this? For example, now this metamaterial is not a material that you only have one configuration, okay? Most materials you work with, it's only one, and that's it. This has an infinite number of configurations, as you can see here. Then you choose one. I don't know which one you choose, whatever. You have an infinite number here, and you may have a preference of configuration over another, depending on the properties that you are looking for. And then, for example, you could print that configuration and study it. And recently, for example, we studied soft materials. What we did, we collaborated with Professor Jerry Shi to start to use digital light processing to print these very soft origami systems, and the reference is here in soft matter, okay? What else do you do with this? We can do a self-interlocking structure. These are only zipper tubes, only zipper. And then you can see here you have the global scale and the local scale. And the local scale is a cellular one. Let me show again. Let me go here. You see, this is the global scale, but this also has a cellular scale. You see here the cellular scale, all right? So has these global and local scales, and it's pretty big. And it's flat foldable. This is an amazing property, flat foldable. And now what else do you do with this? For example, you can do, for example, a bridge, a deployable bridge, and you can see that this bridge is quite strong. And you can load it. It's very deployable. It's quite deployable in one direction, near zero stiffness, and very stiff in this direction that you are loading, okay? And now can we, but here we are in the engineering scale, but materials are at the micro nano scale. Can we do that? Yes, turn out the answer is yes. And we studied micro scale origami architected metamaterials showing a macro scale reversible auxeticity. And now this metamaterial system, we have done it at this size. Take a look here. This scale bar is 30 microns. The whole thing is less than 100 microns. This is the size of your hair. Okay, this is the size of your hair. And this turned out to be one of the smallest origami metamaterials ever done in the world. Here, each panel is about 13 microns. Then we did a rigid origami model, and we fabricated this by means of a 3D direct laser writing using a two-photon polymerization technique, essentially available in this nanoscribe machine. All the testing was done in situ, inside the scanning electron microscopy machine, as illustrated here. And you can see, I'll just point out a couple of properties. It's highly anisotropic, as you can see here. Doing the test in different directions give you tremendously different stiffnesses. And this is the most interesting one. This material is a polymer type material and is a viscous material. Then if we load it in the way shown here with a modulation loading, as you can see here in the inset, then you can see that I get, for example, an elastic more or less with a plateau, a long plateau, right? This flows a long plateau type behavior. And then this is the region 1, 2, 3. Take a look here, 5. This deformed a lot. This is quite squeezed. But then if you unload, okay, go to 7, then wait half an hour, then you almost go back to one. And this shows that this has a lot of resilience and is quite reversible, this behavior, that is quite interesting to study and to apply this in different type of applications regarding resilience. One quick comment. Here is a rigid origami model. If we look at this angle, psi versus the Poisson ratio, there is a sweet spot in this metamaterial. When psi is around 45 degrees. To the left, the Poisson ratio is positive, the yellow region. To the right, it's negative. So we could have a reversible auxeticity behavior. And this is amazing because the Poisson ratio is a surrogate for many properties of materials, right? Not just static, dynamic, acoustic, and so on. And this could be explored. And we investigated this behavior both experimentally to detect the negative Poisson ratio there close to the point that I showed you, and also numerically. This work was published in the journal SMALL, as you can see here. And we used origami to create architected metamaterials, and it allows for large degree of shape recoverability and resilience, is highly anisotropic, and shows reversible auxeticity. How much time I have, Nate? I see the time, 7 minutes.
Okay, right? 7 minutes, but questions included. Okay.
Okay, then I'll try to finish in a couple of minutes. This is the final part of the work. Then where we are studying untethered origami robots with distributed actuation. And this pattern that you see here now is the Kreisling origami pattern. The black plates that you see here, those are magnetic plates, essentially neodymium iron boron plates. And this, I talked about bistability, and I showed you Merlin looking at the bistable behavior of the Miura Ori. And what is interesting is that the Kreisling is also bistable. This is one stable state, the folded configuration. This is another stable state, the deployed configuration. And each one can be controlled independently, and this gives us also a means for digital computing. And for example, here I have three units, and then I would have 2^3 that are 8 states that can be independently controlled, as we are going to see here. So why the magnetic actuation? Very quickly is that in general, actuation is complicated because when you are going to actuate, you need power, and then you need wires, electrical supply, controller, and so on. And these things tend to be bulky. We wanted to have a non-contact actuation. And then we are using magnetic fields. This is a magnetic plate. And one thing we like is that this can be very fast. This is the magnetic field. And now take a look. This has already been actuated. I am showing it again. And again, this is just a tenth of a second. This is so fast that now I'll put it 20 times slower than you can see. Okay, and this is what we wanted, a distributed controlled actuation. And this is the Kreisling pattern. Essentially, this is formed spontaneously. If you pick up 2 tubes and roll a paper on it, it will form like that. And here is Larissa demonstrating. And as I indicated, this pattern is bistable, has 2 stable states, 0 folded, 1 deployed. And I'll try to finalize. Oops. Okay, then here we use the magnetic actuation to do that. And for example, here is the actual behavior of the pattern. If the torque that is supplied is not sufficient, nothing happens. If it is higher than the barrier, like the red line, then it will deploy. And this offers us a means, for example, to look at assemblies and have also a means for mechanical and digital computing. And I can also look at different configurations before all the crises were aligned. Here I have reverse crises. And then I can navigate the magnetic landscape. Finally, this is the test of the Kreisling unit. I'll just make a point that we need to find the energy barrier to know how to actuate this. And just take a look here. A smaller height requires a smaller force. Bigger height requires bigger force. Then here we transform geometry into mechanics, mechanics into geometry, because then just based now on the geometry, we know exactly how the bistable pattern is going to behave. And finally, we did a magneto-mechano-electric Kreslin assembly. And we put here copper tapes to do a Smith trigger circuit so that when the circuit is closed, then the system, I am in the stable state zero that is folded and open in the state one. And this is here what we get. This is the magneto-mechano-electric Kreslin assembly. And this is the last animation I am going to show. And this is the trigger Smith circuit. And here now is the system deploying and exploring all the independent states. Okay, so thank you very much. I said maybe just to point out, we just extended this work for a stretchable robotic arm with omnidirectional bending and twisting. This was just published in the PNAS. The reference is here. Then this concludes the work. Thank you. I hope we have time for a couple of questions.
Okay. Thank you, Glaucio, for the very nice presentation, as always. And we don't have much time. But so then I go directly to the questions here. There is a question by Professor Philippe Devaux. Is the origin of any origami pattern a plane?
Sorry, yeah, say it again.
The origin of any origami pattern is always a plane. Does a plane a sheet of paper? Is that always the case?
This
is
that's correct.
The question.
That's correct. Yes. Well, origami, in the most fundamental way, may have deviations to that. For example, if you do kirigami, that will involve a cutting. But origami, yes, no cut, folding only. Origami is very restrictive. It's very beautiful. Extremely restricted,
yeah.
Holding only.
Yeah, there are two questions by one question by Alvaro Coutinho. Maybe so you can ask directly, Alvaro, because so you are here too. Okay, or I can read what you wrote.
I'm wondering, Glaucio, how do you see, for instance, how to you see deployment of this folded structure for house construction? Imagine we can print a house and then boom, deploy it. Immediately, can you see a future on this?
Absolutely, Alvaro. And Elon Musk talks about sending people to Mars. There is no way that you are going to Mars without your idea. Absolutely, space exploration is impossible without origami. Even a space station, you said the house is for humans. That's correct. But for example, the space station, even the ones I had in the slides, anything you put inside the rockets, right, has to be folded. And then when you reach in space, then you have a gigantic, thousands of times gigantic shape change.
Okay. Okay, thank you. And also Marcelo Trindade says here, congrats on the very exciting talk, Glaucio. What are the limitations of ideal properties for the materials and adhesives?
That's an excellent question, and we may need also to follow up, even separate, I can make a few comments. Yeah, there is origami has a very beautiful mathematical theory behind it. However, when we are going to engineering and then we have different materials, then the properties, the behavior will be different, and that needs to be considered. And that's one of the reasons, for example, that we developed Merlin to understand the mechanical behavior, and not just mechanical properties, but as we are studying here, as you have seen, electrical properties, mechanical properties, like I demonstrated the magneto-mechano-electric system. And anytime that this is an emerging field, I think origami is a very exciting field. There is a lot to be done. The mathematics has been developed a lot, but the engineering has not, and the engineering includes materials, and there are some studies that have been made. I have done some studies to understand the influence of material properties in origami. The paper is in the Royal Society 2000, 19, I think, is a paper with Larissa, actually, on the mechanical behavior of origami assemblages, and other groups have also done it. But what I would like to say is that there is a lot to be done, and especially in engineering, is an emerging field. There is much, much more that we do not know than things that we know.
Ok, Glaucio. Américo Barbosa da Cunha Jr., I think you know him very well. Glaucio, excellent talk. With fast actuation, some dynamic effects may become important in a crescent pattern origami. So it's a question. If yes, do you believe they can be exploited in a constructive way?
Excellent question, Américo. Yes, we ignore the... You are absolutely right. Especially when the actuation is fast, then we excite the dynamic modes. And we ignore the... In this study that we did, we ignore the dynamic effects. However, those are extremely important. And I hope that you can come here for us to collaborate on these studies. And not only that, I think dynamics is an area that... again, not much has been done in origami, and there is a lot to be done for us, for example, to control the origami, to understand the bend gaps. For example, we can program bend gaps. This would be fascinating. Or we can program topological protection based on geometry. Topological protection was the topic of the Nobel Prize in 2016. These are fascinating ideas, but none of this has been done yet. And I hope you, Américo, that asked the question can be the major driving force moving this forward.
Glaucio, maybe I ask ask last question here, and then we go to break, okay? To our good friend, Roberto Daledoni Machado, is an excellent presentation, Glaucio. Which are the similarities between origami and tensile structures?
Origami
last
and
question. Tensile structures. Tensile structures. Do you know tensile structures?
Is it tensegrity?
Tensegrity, yes. It's related to tensegrity. Tensegrity, yes.
That's an excellent question. There are actually, I believe that you can use origami, for example, to inspire the tensegrity behavior and vice versa. And the tensegrity is fascinating because this is a pre-stress system. It does not exist in the undeformed configuration, only the deformed configuration. And tensegrity have a fascinating behavior, especially low-order tensegrity, like class 1 tensegrity, where all the compression members are floating, and the compression members are discontinuous, and the tension members are continuous. And Tomohiro Tashi has done a very interesting study trying to find similarities between a class 1 tensegrity and the origami. And I would like to refer you to that paper. It's quite fascinating.
Okay, Klaus, thank you very much. We would remain here, stay here forever talking about that. But it's time for our coffee and so water break. And so,
you said you had a comment about the Scientific America.
Okay, I talked to you. Okay, maybe I take so 1 minute here because I used to be an avid reader of Scientific American, and I liked very much Martin Gardner's column on mathematical games, and then Douglas Hofstadter succeeded to him in writing this column, but he changed the name to Metamagical Themas. It's an anagram. And I would say that Douglas Hofstadter would call what you're doing, you and colleagues and all them, this would be mathemagics. So you are combining mathematics and art. So something like that via origami. Okay. But okay, it's too late. Thank you very much on behalf of the whole organization. And let's go for coffee break and then our mini symposium. Okay, thank you all.